네. 열띤 일들이 벌어지고 있는데 이 어두운 공간에 찾아주신 여러분들 대단히 감사하다는 말씀드리고요. 되게 좋은 자리라는 생각이 들었어요. 어제 또 이전 이곳 시작하기 전에도 좀 봤었고 어제도 다시 와서 보고 오늘도 말씀 많이 나누면서 자꾸 느낀 겁니다만 되게 이분을 묘사할 만한 이 아직 단어나 어떤 어떤 범주나 이분이 어디에 들어가는지 그거를 모르는 사람의 잘 알기 힘든 사람의 작품을 만난다는 게 쉽지 않은 것 같은데 요 한 몇 년 개인적으로는 봤던 분들 중에 좀 되게 분명한 인상을 남기는 사람이라는 생각이 분명히 들고 그래서 이거를 김은희 선생님도 어떻게 잡으셨냐고 어떻게 찾으셨냐고 누구한테 추천을 받으셨냐 여쭤봤더니 유튜브를 통해서 우연히 보시다가 짧은 걸 보고 이거 뭐 한국 표현으로 좀 물건이다 하고 하죠. 그래서 그렇다고 하셔서 저 되게 놀랐는데 보면서도 저도 특히 이 작은 모니터로 보던 거하고 이 공간에서 주는 특히 사운드하고 같이 맞물리면서 주는 어떤 그 물질감 같은 것들이 이렇게 이분을 쉽게 범주하기 쉽게 만들지 못하는 아주 좋은 의미에서 아주 드문 의미에서 그렇다는 생각을 확신을 좀 갖게 됐습니다. 그래서 여러분들이 오늘 보시고 이전에 다른 작품들 이미 보셨었다 하더라도 혹은 오늘 처음 오신 분들이라 하시더라도 앞으로 다음 주까지 좀 시간이 남아있는데 단편 장편에 대한 기준 자체도 일반적으로 생각하는 장편이 되지 못하는 의미에서 단편을 만드는 느낌도 아니고 장편이라고 해서 또 장편이라고 생각하는 어떤 스토리라인이 있어서 그거에 맞추는 어떤 그런 요구 조건을 이렇게 충족시키는 차원의 그런 것도 아니라는 의미에서는 단편 장편을 가리지 않으시고 시간이 될 때마다 보시면 좋겠다는 생각을 그런 추천을 되게 오랜만에 드리는 생각 드릴 만한 분이라는 생각이 좀 들었습니다. 이분 간단하게 몇 가지만 좀 이미 이렇게 나와 있는 정보들이 있긴 있습니다만 오늘 좀 이따 케빈 감독님께서 이 감독님이라고도 말씀이고 애매하다는 말씀도 하나 어제 나눴었죠. 그러니까 이분이 일반적인 의미에서 영화를 만드는 그런 범주로만 또 들어가는 분도 아니거든요. 특히 자신이 조각을 했었다라는 거에 대한 그 자의식이 되게 뚜렷한 분이시고 인스톨레이션도 하시고 사진도 찍으시고 그러신데 그런 의미에서는 이분을 뭐 감독님이라고만 부르는 소위 말하는 디렉터라고 부르는 차원으로 하는 건 약간 좀 오해가 있을 수 있다는 생각도 드립니다. 그런 차원에선 미술이나 또 다른 여러 가지 중간 작업 하시는 분들에게도 충분히 도움이 될 거라는 생각이 들면서요. 몇 가지만 기본적인 것들을 이 관련되는 차원에서만 몇 개 집어서 말씀을 드리자면 감독님 65년생이시고 오하이오라는 미국 주의 이제 맨스필드라는 곳에서 이제 나오셨는데 이 지역성 자체가 갖는 게 되게 좀 독특한 게 많이 있습니다. 단편이고 장편이고 겉으로 봤었을 때 이 단편이 이게 도대체 이게 오하이오랑 무슨 상관이지 했는데 뭐 예를 들면 자동차가 부서지는 것만 나오는데 그 자동차의 부품을 사실은 이 오하이오에 있었던 공장 사람들이 만들었더라. 근데 그 공장은 이미 다 뭐 다쳤거나 뭐 이런 것들이 되게 많거든요. 계속 그 로컬한 지역적인 것에만 이렇게 대단히 천착하시고 그러시는 것 같은데 거기에 담기지 않는 지점들 같은 게 있어요. 그리고 이분이 자기가 이 미국 중서부라고 하는데 미드웨스트라고 하는데 저희 같은 경우도 한국 보면 뭐 경상도면 경상도 뭐 전라도면 전라도 어떤 지역성에 대한 것들을 이렇게 가지고 어떤 이렇게 부딪히는 이미지들이 있지 않습니까? 그러니까 그것에 대한 자의식도 되게 좀 강하신데 그 얘기들 차원에서도 이따 나중에 좀 말씀을 해주시면 좋겠다는 생각도 들고 또 연장선에서 하나 덧붙이자면 이분 웹사이트에도 보면 그렇고 그러니까 African American이라고 하죠. 그러니까 미국 흑인의 차원을 그걸 붙이는데 그 말이 그 이 감독님의 이분의 작품을 다 설명하기 힘든데 그렇다 그 말을 떼기도 되게 애매해요. 이게 되게 좀 애매한데 왜냐하면 뭐 또 하나는 또 뭐냐면 working class, 그러니까 저희 노동자 계급이라고 하죠. 그 사람들의 이 나오는 이미지들이 되게 많은데 우리가 그 말을 쓰면 노동자 계급이라고 하면 뭐 막시즘이건 뭐건 어떻게 역시 또 떠오르는 이미지들이 있잖아요. 거기에도 또 딱 맞지가 않아요. 그래서 손으로 뭔가를 잡으려고 하면 그 모래 사이로 빠져나가듯이 그 사이에서 계속 이렇게 삐져나가는 게 있거든요. 근데 그 말을 또 안 쓰면 안 되고 그래서 그런 차원에서 이분이 어떤 의미에서는 저도 계속 다시 보면서 이분이 작품이 가지고 있는 힘에 비해서 많이 알려지지 않은 게 이유가 있다는 생각이 좀 들더라고요. 이런 분들은 도대체 어떻게 해야 하나라는 생각도 좀 들고. 또 연장선에서 하나 짚어야 될 이분 상도 많이 받긴 받으셨습니다. 구겐하임 펠로우십이든지 뭐 아메리칸 아카데미 롬 프라이즈니 뭐 여러 가지 상 되게 많이 받으셨는데 이분이 딴 거보다 작품 수가 장편이라고 하는 것이 한 여기 제가 받은 걸로는 최신 걸로가 9개고 다시 있는 게 단편이라고 할 만한 게 여기 적혀 있는 게 125개로 제가 들었는데 어제 말씀 나올 땐 140개가 넘는다고 잘 기억을 못 한다고 하시더라고요. 근데 그거는 이 작품하고 또 뭐가 관련이 되냐면 이게 소위 말해서 어떤 이렇게 평가가 되거나 기술이 될 거라는 어떤 기준이 있는 분이라면 이렇게 많이 안 만드실 것 같다는 생각이 들어요. 이건 이렇게 사람들이 보기 저렇게 보겠지 하는 그런 어떤 좋은 의미에서의 강박이 좀 없다랄까 그런 차원의 것들도 좀 있고 몇 가지 안 되는 인터뷰 같은 것들을 봐도 이분이 이렇게 다른 사람들이 혹시 이분 영향을 받으셨습니까 뭐 이런 거 어떻게 생각하시나 이런 얘기들 하면 되게 농반 진반으로 난 그런 거 별로 신경 안 쓴다라는 말씀도 되게 많이 하시고 근데 그게 많은 예술가들이 그런 걸 되게 이렇게 예의상 혹은 일반적으로 하는 경우들이 많지만 그게 그냥 예의상 하는 얘기가 아니라 정말 이분이 보는 혹은 만들어내는 어떤 그 작품의 텍스처 자체가 실제로 거기에 잘 들어맞지 않는다라는 되게 좋은 의미에서 그렇다는 생각이 많이 들거든요. 근데 제가 지금 말씀드리는 게 어떤 의미에서는 처음 오신 여기 오늘 다른 작품을 보지 않으셨던 분들은 혹은 어떻게 이미 보셨다 하시더라도 지금 제가 말씀드리는 것들이 되게 추상적인 수 있다는 생각이 드는데 오늘 감독님께서 준비해 오신 슬라이드든지 이렇게 동영상 같은 것들이 좀 있거든요. 이렇게 어떤 해답을 주거나 매뉴얼을 드리는 건 아니겠습니다만 이거 되게 볼만하겠다 싶으신 어떤 그런 차원의 어떤 자극을 분명히 줄 수 있을 거라는 생각이 좀 들고요. 그래서 제 얘기는 구체적인 질문들은 말씀하시고 보여주신 것들 하고 나서 나중에 제가 원래 준비했던 일반적인 어떤 스탠다드한 포맷 같은 게 있었는데 다시 다른 인터뷰나 감독님 작가님하고 말씀을 나누면서 이런 식의 건 필요가 없겠다는 생각을 좀 많이 했어요. 그래서 그런 부분을 많이 지우기로 하고 감독님 작가님께 곧장 들어가서 얘기를 해보고 보여주시는 걸 보면서 오늘의 상황을 좀 어떤 의미에서 라이브처럼 잘 만들어서 좀 뽑아보면 좋겠다는 생각을 좀 해봤습니다. 이쯤에서 이제 케빈 작가님께 돌리면 좋지 않을까 싶습니다.
Thanks, McDonald. Maybe it can happen. I guess I just want to probably talk about artists and other artwork that influenced my films. Do you want me to? Oh, okay. Sure. Okay. Artists and artwork that influenced my films, and the image behind you is this famous American comedian. His name is Richard Pryor. He was born in 1940 and died in 2005, and he was what we considered a blue comic, but I guess here it's a pink comic, which means he tells dirty jokes, and he has this famous, I'm going to blush because it's a dirty joke. That's how I start out, yeah. It's basically... he has this comic routine about cunnilingus, and then he starts off. He says, "I'm acting like Richard Pryor." So my uncle says, "Boy, whatever you do, don't eat no pussy." And then a pause. Then Richard Pryor says, "I can't wait to eat some pussy because my uncle's been wrong about everything in his life, and I like." And then of course the joke continues into him being a young man and cunnilingus, but I like the uncle, and then the fact that like an individual can be described and a character can be described quickly by one description, so I like him, so I like the minor figure in a narrative becoming a major figure. I thought I'd get a rise out of it. Okay. Humber Light, okay. But another thing about this artist, Richard Pryor, and I refer to like a lot of people as artists. My parents, they were, my father was a mechanic, my mom was a bank teller. So, you know, like this was considered high art to us, you know, like they would let me and my brother hear these albums or recordings of him, even though they were for adults, but they understood that this was like very important, kind of cultural. And also, like me and my parents, the artist Richard Pryor, who was from another Midwestern region called Illinois, he was also, his family migrated from the southern part of the United States to the Midwestern part of the United States for labor. And then, so there was a kind of a connection for that, for us as well. Another artist that's very influential to my work is the playwright, Lorena Hansberry, who was born in 1930 and died in 1965. She was from Chicago, Illinois, and her famous work is Rising in the Sun, a play about an African-American Chicago family. And what I like about her as an artist is that she has these quick, like her plays are very emotional. They go from sad 1 second and to joyous the other second. And so I like that as a kind of a narrative formal device. Yeah, and another work that's very influential is this, as Youngbin said, I studied photography, sculpture, printmaking, painting, and I did some theater, some dance. So I did a lot of kind of visual arts. And one of the main photographers that were influenced me was this photographer named Gary Winogram, who was born in 1929 and died in 1974. This photograph is interesting because I show it because I like the fact, I got a little laser pointer here. I like the fact that that each individual in the photograph inhabit their own square. And I like, and then the thing I like to do is take a three-dimensional scene and flatten it to a two-dimensional plane, and using the formal qualities like line, color, shapes to enhance the two-dimensionality of the scene. So I like the fact that they're in their little squares, and they're different. This is an African-American young man, and this is a white American older man, and then how he talks about, although it's about formal qualities, but also it's about social conditions as well. Formal qualities, you know, like artistic, like lines, color, shapes, yeah. Another artist influencing me is this Swiss couple called Fischl and Weiss, and this is a sculptural piece where it's called Room Behind the Stairs. And so everything that you see is carved out of polyurethane and painted. Yeah. Yeah. And then I like how they make art out of objects that don't seem important. So in this particular exhibition, the artwork is based on objects that install art. You know, so like, you know, the hammer, the ladder, spackle, the paint, so like, so to speak. So everything is like kind of made up. And then so the viewer can look into this window and see the objects. Like you can see the sink, and then another image is that then you can see these carved objects that look like paint cans or paint jugs. But for me, I respond to this because it's the small gesture of narration that I like. Like I like how two of the paint jugs are painted green to the top, meaning that they're filled of paint, and then the last one is there's a third of it is or a quarter of it is green, so it has a backstory. So like the objects to make that small artistic gesture, meaning that like gives it like a little bit of a narrative. Yeah, and everything in this image is sculpture. Yeah, it's, you know, it's like it's all carved.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah, everything is sculpture.
Except the wall.
No. Yeah. Except. Right? Yeah, except for the wall, okay. The wall and the floor, okay. But everything is sculpture.
So 지금 뒤에 벽하고 바닥을 제외한 지금 사진 속에 보이는 모든 게 다 조각된 겁니다.
Yeah. This next image, I found this street artwork in Detroit, Michigan, another Midwestern industrial city. I think everybody knows Detroit is the home of the automobile. And the automobile cars, yeah, automobile, and, huh?
Not everyone knows it. That's right. I'll explain. For
just continue.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then, so in this particular this particular object I saw, I took this photograph of this street art, and I like the fact that the paint cans are formally like the tree stumps, and for me, right in the middle. It's almost like a film edit where the tree stumps become paint cans and the paint cans become tree stumps. And this image here is an example of my photographic artwork. And these particular, I'm gonna show four images, and they're all four taken with this camera called a Widelux camera, which is a panoramic camera that photographs 140 degree angle, and the lens moves, and so the event on the left side begins before the event on the right side, so it's almost like a little film, and I like it because it's a photograph, and the photograph is not real, and this is really not real, because it's a kind of a fake narrative, so to speak, and in these images, I was photographing African Americans posing or performing with objects or element of representation or art. Yeah, and this is another example of it. This is another example, and the later ones, the framing, which I'm going to talk about too as well. So the framing of the image becomes a little bit more aggressive, and the bodies are cut off. Yeah, so I was showing a little bit of the photography work, and like I said, I did painting, printmaking, and some other performance art, and some other things. But when I got into film, it was actually from my sculptural work. And this particular piece, which was a series of sculptural things. I used to be a woodworker, really well woodworker. I used to make furniture. And this piece is based on my parents' end tables. And then I was making artwork at this particular, this is mid-90s, I was making artwork that presented the so-called art object in the African-American Midwestern home. And in this particular piece, the title of it was called Mansfield, Ohio, End Tables. Yeah, and is that end table, is that, can you use that for furniture? Yeah. Which is an end table. It sits on either side of the sofa in homes. And what I was trying to say with this piece was that I was actually making work about black migration. Like my family came from the southern part of the United States, a place called Mississippi, up to the northern part, midwestern part of Ohio. And so the pictures on the end table, one is from my mother's yearbook, and the other image, the bigger image, is from a picture of friends that I went to school with. And around this time in the mid-90s, the factories began to close up around the 80s, and the main industry in my hometown was prisons. And then so the best jobs was in the prison institutions. And in America, we have over 2 million prisoners, I think. And then so the whole ideal of humans being of a commodity and crime being a commodity was important to my hometown. So it was this kind of,
it's just like a catch-22.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like the catch-22 was the more crime in the bigger cities in my state, the more jobs my friends had. What I liked about these particular sculptures, there's probably about 12 of these, and they function as actual pieces of furniture because I still own two, like in my home. But when I made these pieces, I was actually explaining them more than I was explaining the process of them more than what they really were. So what I was saying to viewers or friends, I was saying that that what I liked about these pieces was, like, I liked that people would work 5 days a week, get paid on Fridays, go and buy furniture on Saturday, put it in their homes, and be kind of proud of it. But what I was explaining to it, I was actually talking about time-based art. I wanted to show that, and that's how I kind of got into films, was I needed, I thought I needed to show the duration of things, the process of how people went to work and earned money to buy furniture, to buy objects for their homes. Yeah, and then so around this particular time, the mid-90s, I started making films because I wanted to put the viewer through a duration of time more so than kind of animate objects or sculptural-like objects. And then so the next thing, I'm going to show a clip from this film that played the other day called Company Line. And what these pieces were doing, I wanted them to talk about the African-American movement of migration, or moving from the north, from the south to the north. And in the film I'm going to show, the few beginning minutes of this film called Company Line, there's going to be several things that are going to be going on. Yeah, so in this film, I made this film called Company Line. The title of it is referred to one of the three first African-American neighborhoods in Mansfield, Ohio. And so I wanted to talk about the beginnings of African-Americans moving to my hometown. And so the narration comes from, in Ohio, we have a lot of bad weather. It's a really horrible weather, and we get a lot of snow. And you don't have a lot of, and then so you have these snowplow truck drivers, these vehicles that push snow so people can go to work in the morning and stuff. So so I wanted the narration of the film told by snowplow truck drivers, because I want to make a difference between the kind of visceral weather that there's not a lot of snow in the southern part of the United States. So that was the difference between the north and the south. But also, too, like, I knew a lot of the snowplow truck drivers who work for the city of Mansfield, and I knew a lot of them came from the south into the north. So in this clip, the individual, which is going to be speaking American English, he talks about his experience from working in multiple jobs and the factories closing down, and moving from the north to the south. So I'm going to show the clip. Okay, it's freezing down here. Okay. Ah, yeah. Oh, yeah, and then we can talk over it, yeah. I'm going to talk over it because there's no subtitles. Tell them, yeah, yeah.
자막이 없어서 보시면서 설명을 해드리겠습니다.
Yeah, and one thing that I like the film, I like film things that work and don't work at the same time. Like a lot of cars on the road are not very good in the United States, so you can see that his windshield wiper fluid thing doesn't work, so he has to keep pouring windshield wiper fluid in front of the car. And I've seen people drive around like that. So it'll basically the film is about it's actually about black migration, and these are individuals who work for the city of Mansfield that are city employees or civil servant workers, and their job is to clear the streets of snow in the wintertime. And this particular device, truck, puts down salt on the road, so it'll melt the ice.
And do you have that here? Do people do that here?
You mean as part of the screening?
Yeah.
Why don't, well, like, actually in the South, we don't do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
But ice too?
Yes.
Or salt?
And he's just basically talking about how much money he makes, what his previous jobs were. And again, in America, the industrial jobs, the factory jobs, actually paid a lot more. So people are actually working harder and making a lot less, whatever, so to speak. Yeah. So he talks about that. But I can, all right. So I'm going to click to the next film clip. And then, yeah, and then here he's talking about his job. The next film, yeah, I'm going to click the next film. This next film, I'm going to wait for the plays. I'm going to pause it. I'm in like an artist sculpture. And what I like is with materials. And I like not just, and I like, and I shoot on various different film formats. Sometimes I shoot with 16 millimeter. Sometimes I shoot with HD or 35 millimeter or Super 8. And then the subject matter dictates what particular format or what kind of camera I use. And in this particular film, and that's very important to me, in this particular film, it's shot with this 16 millimeter camera called a Bolex. And in film, 24 frames, film runs 24 frames a second sound speed. But on some cameras, you can actually shoot one frame at a time. So that's how animation is done. Old school animation, everything is now digital. And so in this particular film, I actually shot shot one frame at a time. And this film was actually shot during, in America about 5 years ago, we had a huge oil spill in the Sea of Mexico. And then here you can see individuals cleaning up the beaches area called Florida. Florida part of the United States, the southern part of the United States. And these are migrant workers from as far as 2,000 miles away. And then there's another, economy in America where the disasters are good, like hurricanes, earthquakes, tornadoes, because you have to clean up. So a lot of people actually make money from these particular disasters. And the oil spill is like another way to make money. So I'm just going to play. It's a silent film, and the title Half On, Half Off, it refers to that it took me 4 hours to shoot this, and the employees, they worked a half an hour on and a half an hour off on the beach. Then I can talk over it, yeah. And they're wearing protective gear because it's oil dispersant, it's called. I don't know. I can't remember. Also, it's like I said, it's going fast because I'm filming one frame at a time, and it looks like animation. Yeah. Most of the workers were of African descent, but I'd like the gestures of labor as a craft. Yeah.
마침 지금 또 이제 제스처 얘기를 하셨던 게 있어서 지금 말씀 들으시면서나 작품 이제 보여주신 걸 보면서 아마 궁금해하시는 분들이 계실 거라는 생각이 드니까 두 가지인데 하나는 이분 작품을 보면서 이분이 말 그대로 흑인 미국 흑인 감독이라는 차원이라는 게 여기에 흑인들이 실제로 많이 나오는 거 그 이상의 게 뭐가 있나? 혹시 그런 어떤 의문이 좀 궁금하실 것 같고 그 얘기는 다르게 질문하자면 이분들이 흑인들의 어떤 이 미국 사람들의 본질을 이게 진짜 흑인이구나 미국 사람들이 이렇게 일하는 게 어떤 흑인의 진실을 리얼리티를 보여주는 건가 어떤 그런 질문들이나 의문들을 가지실 거라는 생각이 들거든요. 요거가 어떤 의미에서는 사실은 감독님께서 직간접적으로 가끔 받으시는 질문이실 것 같다는 생각도 들고 상대적으로 한국에서 제가 생각하기에도 미국이라는 영역 안에서 농담입니다만 한국에서 흑형이라고 하죠. 이렇게 그 힙합이나 이런 거 좋아하시는 분 잘 아시겠습니다만 그 이렇게 소위 말하는 이제 셀러브리티라고 하죠. 유명한 사람들 음악이나 이런 데서 이렇게 막 현란하게 나타나는 사람들 아닌 차원의 것들 거기 속하지 않는 지점들에 대한 얘기들이 좀 있는데 그 얘기를 한번 하나 해주셨으면 좋겠다는 생각이 들고, 그러니까 이게 만약에 미국 흑인들의 어떤 그 본질 이런 걸 드러내는 걸 우리가 받아들여도 되겠느냐라고 만약 사람들이 생각한다면 뭐라고 대답하시겠느냐 어떤 예.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. Is that a question?
Yeah.
Yeah. No. The answer would be, I guess, well, because I'm showing, because it's not a window to reality. It's more just like these kind of moments and stuff, so to speak. Yeah.
그러니까 yeah. 그걸 저도 이제 시작하는 차원에서 이제 여쭤본 겁니다만 그 차원에서 하나 또 맞물려 있는 게 다른 작품들 어제 상영됐던 것도 그렇고 다른 그 장편으로도 그런 게 많은데 보면은 실제로 뭐 이 감독님의 이 저 작가님의 친척분들이나 아는 분들이 출연한 영화들이 많은데 거기 보면 실제로 그 현실에 기반해 있지 않은 것들이 많은데 그걸 우리한테 얘기를 해주질 않거든요. 그러니까 이게 현실하고 페이크하고 약간 이렇게 페이크라고 하긴 그렇습니다만 만드는 지점들이 이렇게 애매하게 이렇게 막 겹쳐지는 지점들이 사실 있는데 그런 거를 얘기를 안 할 때 오해가 생길 수도 있지 않겠냐는 질문을 사람들이 할 수도 있을 것 같아요. 이거 난 진짜인 줄 알았는데 전혀 뭐 얘기가 없었지 않느냐 작품에서 봤었을 때 그런 질문을 만약 누가 한다고 하면 처음 질문으로 연관이 되는 거겠죠.
Well, I mean, I think I like to use reality as a device. So if people think it's real, then I'm fine with it, because that's what I'm trying to reconstruct, so you know, like so to speak. So that's okay, yeah. So they don't have to know that it's my relatives in the film, because they're relative, because they're just convenient, and then it gives me access to things, like I think, so to speak. So I think that's so I think for me as the artist, like that's important, but it's not important to the viewer to know, for them to know that I know these people, so to speak, yeah.
You don't have to pay them as much.
Oh, yes, you do. I really got to pay them as much. Yeah, that last film, Half on Half Off, was about time. It's about, like, and then that's one of the materials I like to play with. Like, that film was 2.5 minutes long, and that's the length of a 32-meter roll of 16-millimeter film. So that was the length of that film. This particular quick scene I'm going to show, and I can just play it and talk over it. Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's silent. In this particular film, I'm just going to play. It's called Park Lanes, and the length of this film is 8 hours long, and I think it plays one more time here. And it's actually watchable. And it's basically, it took... me and a crew 3 days. We filmed in a factory that made bowling alley supplies, and we filmed in there for 3 days, and I constructed together for a full work day in the United States is 8 hours, and so the film lasts 8 hours long, and then there's a half an hour lunch in there too as well. And so the whole idea of it being real time is important to me, to put the, not quite put the viewer through the real time, but the whole idea of it being time being a materiality, so to speak. And the I wanted to film a big ticket item, like film a car being made from beginning to end. And I used to work in factories as a college student in the summer. So I made washing machines. But it was hard to get permission for that. So what I did, I just actually filmed workers working on objects that look like sculptural objects, that look like kind of art, like the references. Yeah, and it's basically just these individuals working in this factory. And I said, like, I used to work in factories, and I always wanted to make a film about that. I don't know if anybody worked in a factory or I doubt it, but I learned a lot in those summers working in the factory about humanity and value of what materialities as opposed to people, so to speak. Yeah. And a few more examples. This is a film that was based on those kind of like those paint cans and those stumps I was talking about the edit in between the two objects. This film is called Eerie, and I think it's playing soon. Oh, it played already? Yeah. And it's basically eight 11-minute long takes put together. And the maximum length of film you can use in a 16-millimeter camera is 133 meters. Yeah, 133 meters long worth of film, which lasts 11 minutes long. So in this particular film, each scene is 11 minutes long. And in this particular moment of the film, these are, again, my relatives who used to work in a General Motors factory, which the factory had closed. And so they're talking about their experience in the General Motors factory. And then the next scene right after this is you're going to see two individuals sword fighting. At first and at last, it doesn't really make much sense. But for me as the artist, it did, because I wanted to talk about workers making things but not showing it. And then the next scene, you have people fighting, actors fighting with swords, and I wanted the sound of the swords to be more important, because these swords were actually made by hand. So the whole idea of people using their hands to manufacture and to make something. And because each scene is 11 minutes long, I wanted the subject matter to concentrate on something for 11 minutes, because the viewer was going to concentrate on something for 11 minutes. Yeah, and so here they're just talking about their experience in the General Motors plant. And actually, I think it was shot in summer of 2009. And my two cousins here, Sadie and Daisy, they're twins, they had just retired from the factory that Friday, and this was a Sunday. But my other cousin, Ad, the gentleman, he had another 12 more years to work in the factory. So they're talking about time in the factory as well. Yeah, he had about 12 more years to go, yeah. I think so, I can't remember. And then these are two actors I saw in another Midwestern city called Buffalo, New York. And then I saw them in a Shakespeare play on a Monday, hired a fight coach, and we filmed it on a Friday, whatever, so. Yeah, and it's just a repetition of them doing the same moves over and over again, yeah.
예, 요즘에서나 이제 또 어제도 그렇고 오늘 하시면서도 자꾸 이렇게 반복해서 쓰시는 용어들 중에 하나가 장면도 그렇습니다만 그 친절하게 앞에 컨텍스트가 이렇게 설명이 돼서 이 사람들이 싸움을 한다고 하면 이게 왜 지금 어떤 이야기를 우리가 찾는다고 하면 그게 나타나지가 않거든요. 이분이 아까도 초반에 얘기하셨던 것 중에 관련이 있다고 생각되는 게 스토리라는 차원의 얘기하고 제스처라는 걸 이렇게 구분을 좀 하세요. 그러니까 액션하고 아까도 쓰셨던 표현을 보면 small gestures of narration이라고 표현을 쓰셨는데 우리가 생각하는 완결된 차원의 스토리가 어떤 서사에 딱 그 완벽한 게 아니라 제스처가 있다라는 식의 말씀하시거든요. 그리고 실제로 정말 이런 식으로 똑같은 동작을 반복하는 그런 것들에 되게 관심이 많이 가세요. 근데 그 앞이나 뒤가 사실은 생략되어 있는 그래서 우리가 뭘 보기는 보는데 어떤 경우 되게 오래 보는데 이걸 우리가 왜 봐야 되는 건지 좀 궁금할 때들이 있거든요. 그래서 그런 구분이 어디서 오는 건지 또 관련되는 게 연결돼서 한번 덧붙이자면 스컵처라는 조각적이라는 표현을 자꾸 쓰시는데 그걸 다른 사람들이 그냥 다 보면서는 그러니까 저는 그 두 개가 제스처라는 거하고 스컵처라고 하는 조각적이라고 하는 것들이 어떤 사람들의 이 모양들 이런 걸 보시는 것 같은 구분선이 있는 것 같은데 그거에 대해서 좀 설명을 좀 해주시면 도움이 되지 않을까라는 생각 좀 해봤습니다.
예. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, of course, yeah. Yeah, I like, again, I teach filmmaking at the University of Virginia, and we mostly do experimental films, but a lot of the students want to do documentary and or make narrative films. So when I teach script writing, there's two types of film. And what I do, and maybe the gesture, is like there is something called a situation, and a situation is the cat sleeping on the blanket. And then when you have, but then when you write a script and make a story, you have the cat sleeping on the dog's blanket. So it has to be the potential for conflict, so to speak. And for me, I like the situation because it could be the middle of something. And then so you can see the cat riveting, you see the cat sleeping on the blanket. And then so when you arrive there as a viewer, you don't know how long the cat's been sleeping. And then when the film's over, you don't know how long the cat, you don't know if the cat's going to be alive or not. You know, it's like the viewer can put in, can add in the front story and the so-called backstory. Yeah, and for me, the films that have a duration of time and unedited time, they feel more sculptural because they are about a situation, but you have to kind of walk around it like a sculpture. Like when I was at the Samsung Museum, I love the 12th century vases I saw, because you have to walk around them, and that takes a duration of time, so to speak. And I like that. And then the viewer can come into the vase at any point or in any time, and then for me, that's more, it's kind of sculptural, and that's what the longer time films are for me, so to speak. They give it time for things to breathe, so to speak, instead of just looking at it from one perspective or one vantage point, yeah. Like a painting or a photograph. And this actually scene, which I'm going to play, with this scene was from the film played yesterday called 10-5 in the Grass, and it's about African-American cowboys. And in it, this particular scene, I like when people are the expert at what they do, and then they have this kind of internal language about how they approach their craft. So we see them practicing calf roping as cowboys with these kind of sculptural things. And in this particular scene, I like it because it's like the photograph I showed that seems like all the figures were cropped off, where there's going to be a lot of, this scene lasts like 6-7 minutes. But you can see things, objects coming in throughout the frame, like that gentleman walked in. People, it's a very active scene. The sound is behind me, sometimes sounds in front of me, and it's just like an interesting situation. Yeah. A very active situation. Yeah. And for me, it's like the Richard Pryor joke that I talked about earlier, where these are all minor figures. They're like the uncle, so to speak, yeah. And thus, I try to make them important. This next example I'm going to show is basically the kind of new art form. And this is a silent film called 93. And it's basically, let me just pause this for a second. Yeah. It's a kind of a new art form that I think it's going to be catching on here in Seoul, South Korea, where And in the galleries, I show in film festivals, art museums, and galleries. And basically now in a lot of art museums and galleries in Europe, United States, and South America, you have, like historically in art museums, you have dark objects on white walls, paintings on white walls, or photographs on white walls. But now you see in a lot of museum galleries, you'll have light objects on dark walls. So you have a gallery that's dark that will project a film that will loop for the duration that the museum is open. And when I participate in this particular genre, when I make films for galleries, I usually have the subject matter in the film dictate how the space of the gallery will look. So in this particular film called 93, you're going to see a gentleman who is 93 years old physically blowing out, in slow motion, blowing out 93 candles. And then when he's finished, the gallery will become dark. And filming this was difficult than you think it was. A, the gentleman is 93 years old, so he had to have oxygen after every shoot, and it took about 3 cakes. We had to get candles from a witch store because they knew candles, you know. So it wasn't an easy, you always think filmmaking is easy. And the next thing I was like, it's like sculpture because you got to know the materials. And I didn't know, And that cake, thank God it's black and white, because you would that cake would be look unedible. It's probably covered in wax by that time. I think we had two or three cakes, but I think that was one of the bad cakes. So, but yeah. And this is a this film that I'm gonna show is called Rough and Unequal, and it's the latest. It's actually brand new. I just installed it in a museum in my hometown. And it's basically the same thing. The subject matter of the film dictates the light that's in the gallery. And this is a two-channel projection, meaning that it's two projections going on once. And it's basically it's one gallery, and in the middle there is a wall in the gallery. And on one side of the gallery, you have this image. And the other, and on the other side of the gallery, we have this image, and then at one time, one gallery gets lighter, and the other one gets darker, and this is the actual moon, and I rigged my 16mm movie camera to the University of Virginia Observatory telescope, and just filmed the moon for 11 minutes. And this is a full roll of film, 130 meters, which is 11 minutes long. And basically, these things are called, I guess it could be called video installation or film installations. And basically, for me, I treat them as moving paintings on the wall. And so, but I always want them to, and the viewer, for me, just when I make them, the viewer doesn't have to be there the full 11 minutes to kind of get what's going on. So it's like you can leave the painting like any time. So I make the films where the viewer don't have to stay the whole time. And this is just an example of a video installation that'll probably be. I think you're going to see a lot of this, and then there's the Samsung Museum has the Eliasson show, and there's a. I don't think there's no. Film installation in there, I don't think. Is there Madeline?
Was it at various places?
Yeah, various places.
좀 전에 그 제스처하고 뭐 스컬처 조각적인 이런 거 관련된 얘기들 몇 가지를 좀 더 붙여서 질문을 한두 개 드리고 그 다음 걸로 좀 넘어가 보도록 하겠는데요. 그 감독님께서 그 작가님께서 다른 인터뷰에서나 뭐 사적인 자리에서나 그 라브디아즈 같은 감독 이 만드는 그 엄청 역시 또 엄청나게 긴 작품들이 많죠. 뭐 8시간 가기도 하고 저도 또 예를 들면 페드로 코스타 같은 경우도 생각을 하기도 했었었어요. 그러니까 어떤 의미에서 노동자 계급 뭐 빈곤한 사람들을 다룬다고 해서 실제로 다루지 않는 게 아니고 계속 그런 사람들이 나오는데 그런 어떤 이런 사람들에서 일반적으로 생각하는 노동자 계급이라든지 빈곤한 사람들의 우리가 막연하게 그 영화라거나 이미지라고 할 때 기대하는 어떤 그 동정심이랄까 그런 것들하고는 또 사실 상관이 살짝 없다고 할 수는 없는데 비껴가는 차원의 것들 형식에 대한 어떤 고민들이 있으신데 그런 것들을 어떻게 이렇게 조율하시는지 그러니까 계속 흑인 노동자들이 계속 나오긴 합니다만 그 사람들을 우리가 불쌍하게 보거나 이 사람들이 엄청나게 당하고 있다 어떤 이 사회 구조의 어떤 그 피해자라거나 이런 것들로 몰아가지 않으시는데 그 어떤 밸런스를 어떻게 맞추시는 건지 좀 되게 궁금해하시는 분들이 있을 것 같아요.
Yeah, for me, it's like, I mean, I'm from a region where it's great to have a job no matter what you do, you know. So the fact that, you know, like, I think it's like exciting when people work in and actually and people take pride in what they do, so to speak. And sometimes I think the ruling class or the kind of educated class or whatever you want to call it, you know, they don't appreciate the complexities and the intellectual and the craft that goes into labor. Yeah, because even in the film Erie, when my relatives were talking about working in the General Motors factory, most of the writings about that film was about they've never heard anybody talk about like people working in a factory before who work there and talked about that they have a skill, you know. Nobody can do their job, but they can do their job, you know. And then for me, it's like I hear people talk about that all the time back home, you know. So I guess like people who work, you know, I think in America, well, we don't want to pay anybody, so we think everybody makes too much money, which is insane, you know, because people don't make enough money, you know. And so I think coming from that particular background, I understand. I mean, I have appreciation for it, I guess, so to speak. And also, too, I know how a lot of the films were actually based on, I think when I got into film, I got into it from the performance art, and so how the body kind of did. And I remember, I've never heard myself say this out loud before, but I remember my earlier films were trying to get at to how labor would change your body, you know, how what you do would physically change your body. Yeah, and I just remember how my parents looked different on Friday than they did on Monday. You know, just the physical, that kind of thing. But also, too, I remember I used to, I always like going to new places, and do people shoot dice here? You know, it's like a gambling game. Yeah, like a game, yeah, craps, right? Yeah, yeah. So I remember going to these illegal, I don't know why I feel like I'm around family here now. I used to go to these illegal dice games and as a teenager, and then you had to leave early because the big money guys were coming, the people who get off work at the steel mill. And I remember these guys would come in and, you know, come in and their forearms would be so huge from like working in the factory. You know, they would shoot that dice, you'd be like, that's all you see was like man arm, you know. And then that was from the physicality of labor and how their physical body would. And then so I think when I started making, I remember I tried to design this film where I was trying to walk up this hill and have my body change because you had to walk up the hill to go to work every day. You know, I was just like, I was into like that kind of gesture, whatever.
그게 지금 말씀하신 게 이제 앞에 얘기했던 거랑 좀 잘 집중이 잘 된다는 생각이 드는 게 금요일하고 부모님이 월요일이 달라 보이시는 게 몸이 변화되는 차원의 얘기들을 자꾸 하시거든요. 뭐 손가락이 큰 손 자체가 커진 사람도 얘기했었습니다만, 그러니까 이게 아까 그 우리가 스토리하고 아까 제가 이 작가님께서 제스처 자꾸 구분하시는 점들이 거기서 좀 나타난다는 생각이 드는 게. 겉에 서머리가 요약 이 단편이나 장편은 이런 것에 대한 것입니다라고 저희가 하고 나서 보기 시작하면 처음에 그걸로 출발은 하는데 중간에 어떤 부분을 보면 제가 좀 전에 아까 보여주셨던 것이 좋아했던 게 그 제목이 그 초원의 카우보이라고 되는 Ten Five in the Grass라는 데 보면 이 흑인 카우보이들이 나오는데 송아지들을 잡아가지고 다리를 묶는 장면들이 한 6분 정도 계속 나오는 지점이 있거든요. 거기 보면 이 사람들이 그냥 막연하게 우리가 생각하는 백인들을 많이 주로 봤었는데 백인들이 이런 역할을 하는구나라고 인지적으로 이야기 차원에서 변화되는 지점보다 이 사람들 대단히 숙련된 어떤 그 몸 자세들이 주는 뭐 아름다움이라고 할까요? 그게 내가 본 적이 없는 거라는 걸 깨닫게 되는 어떤 순간들이 이렇게 등장하는 것 같아요. 그러니까 그게 이분이 겉으로 나타나 있는 여기 저희가 이제 뭐 빌플릭도 있습니다만 그거에서 어떤 차이라는 걸 이분이 이제 자꾸 뭐 스컬처를 하다 조각적이라든지 어떤 대상을 볼 때 자꾸 퍼포먼스 차원에서 본다고 하는 것이 어떤 핵심 중에 않을까라는 생각이 좀 들었고 그 대상이 아마 또 무엇보다 이 흑인 우리가 아까 처음 말씀드렸던 그 사람들에 대해 가지고 있는 신기하게 어떤 그 이 고정된 이미지들이 있지 않습니까? 그게 모르면 모르는 대로 그러니까 거기서 구분되는 차원의 어떤 핵심이라는 생각이 들고 그러니까 예 요 차원에서 하나 질문을 드리자면 이런 정도의 얘기들이 좀 필요한 이유 중에 하나는 이분을 예를 들면 뭐 미술 쪽에서건 영화 쪽에서건 어떤 계보랄까요? 어디에 위치를 시켜야 될지 궁금해하시는 분들이 여기뿐만 아니라 미국에서 되게 많은 것 같아요. 그래서 그 예를 들면 뭐 흑인 영화 미국 같은 경우에 한다고 할 때 뭐 초기에 데이비드 그리피스 나왔을 때 오스카 미셸라는 감독들도 있고 뭐 그때부터 해서 쭉 나중에 가면 뭐 요 최근에 뭐 테런스 낸스라든지 아니면 그 70년대 이럴 때 뭐 해리 제리마 뭐 이런 사람이든지 찰스 버넷신 이런 사람들 얘기를 하는데 그런 걸 인터뷰에서 여쭤보시면 아 난 그런 사람 별로 관련 없고 난 되게 뭐 농담 반 진담만 하시면서 그런 얘기 하지 말라고 뭐 혹은 뭐 이 작가분에 대해서 박사 논문을 쓰고 싶은 사람이 학생들이 뭐 선생님 뭐 혹시 이런 거 보셨나요? 저런 거 영향 받으신 거 아닌가? 아 그런 거 네가 공부해줘 나한테 물어보냐고 뭐 이렇게 잘라버리신다고 하시더라고요. 그러니까 앞쪽에 자꾸 작품 구체적인 어떤 그 제스처나 동작에 대한 얘기를 해야 되는 이유 중에 하나는 이분의 이미지 안에 나오는 어떤 우리가 찾을 만한 영향을 받을 만한 어떤 그 계보 같은 것들이 좀 이렇게 잘 드러나지 않는 지점이 있을 것 같아 있어서 그런 것 같은데 그걸 의식적으로 이렇게 떨궈내시려고 하는 건지 아니면 그런데 관심이 전혀 없으신 건지 그냥 아예 나는 한국 표현 좀이 아닙니다만 독고다이라고 하나요 이렇게 혼자 예, 정제된 용어를 써야 되는 죄송합니다만 그렇게 하시는 건지 어떻게 그거에 대해서 좀 얘기를 그러니까 나는 혼자서만 예, 어떤 계보에 속하지 않는 그런 사람들 얘기들을 원래 싫어서 아예 하시는 건지 그거 얘기를 좀 해주시면 어떨까 싶습니다. 예.
Yeah.
또 줄이면 이 감독님 작품이 좀 그런 것 같아서 말씀드리면 African American Tradition이 만약에 영화적인 영상적인 차원에 있다면 그것과의 관계를 어떻게 설정하시는지.
Well, I mean, I think if there was something called Black aesthetic, I guess people there is a desire to find that in the United States, so we could separate ourselves from the ruling class, but. I think would be the kind of like in the first clip, company line where somebody is like pouring windshield wiper fluid, and you make do. That saying, you know, idea of like you accept it and evolve from that and make it work and make it interesting. So I like that as as form, you know, how can I, you know, kind of create, basically you want to create your own language, you know, and then for me, I like artwork and films and whatever, and dance or poetry, where the artist or writer or choreography invites us to their world. And then it's telling us like, this doesn't exist until I tell you that this exists, you know, like, this is something, you know, so I want to kind of create, you know, so the desire to create my own language and create your own, you know, to make do, to kind of find these elements that, and then for me, it's like, you know, it's like the history of blues, like there's a guitar, but we're going to make it sound different, because last night I went to the, we went to this dance studio, the 1 million dance studio, and they're a YouTube sensation in the United States, and they dance like American hip hop, you know, and it's interesting going there, and then now I'm getting used to seeing people who don't look like me doing hip hop dances. So like Koreans are cool, you know, because they know how to dance, right? You know, Russians aren't because they don't know how to dance. No, I don't know. You got to be tribal but anyway, you know, I like, but then also too in the history of like that in American culture where like a lot of like African Americans would like wear their pants big, sagging, you know, just whatever white culture is like, then we're going to do the complete opposite. You know, and then how like the black women would do their hair, it's like it's not like anything else, you know. So it's that kind of making that kind of creating your own kind of language, so to speak. And then I mean, I don't consciously do that, but you know, but I do want to have an invitation to the viewer to a different world, so to speak. And it's more, it's mostly artistic formally, but yeah.
Does that mean? We should do our hip hop.
Good blues, huh?
What? I'm dancing.
I know. I'm keeping up. Don't worry.
Yeah. 그 자꾸 하시는 말씀 다른 데서도 그렇고 흑인 문화라고 하면 흑인 영화라고 흑인들의 이미지가 있다고 하면 그거 자체가 어떻게 영웅적이면 영웅적인 게 있고 그렇지 않으면 한편에서 이제 또 피해자가 되는 어떤 그런 게 있죠. 뭐 작년인가 재작년에 그 스파이크 리가 만든 그 쉐이락이라는 그 영화 보면 시카고에서 벌어지는 흑인들 안에서 총기 사고로 죽는 사람들의 1년의 숫자가 이라크 전쟁에서 벌어졌던 미국 전사자들도 더 많다는 그 통계 가지고 이제 되게 문제가 좀 독특한 문제인데 그런 거 하는 거 보면 두 개가 이렇게 기이하게 합쳐져 있는 경우도 있거든요. 흑인들이 피해자이면서 또 백인들에 대항해서 영웅이 돼야 되는 게 있는데 이 작가님이 만드시는 작품 안에서 드러난 흑인들은 흑인이 맞는데 그 두 양쪽의 축에 어디에도 속하지 않고 가운데서 기이하게 어떤 회색존이랄까요? 거기서 이렇게 놓는데 그게 일반적인 의미에서 또 뭐 어떤 되게 재미없고 지루한 롱테이크 속에서 나타나는 뭐 진실, 현실 이런 거하고는 또 다른 그러니까 거기에 어떤 그런 제스처에 대한 게 단단하게 이미 뿌리받고 있는 이렇게 이분들이 생활해 오신 지가 대단히 오래됐다라는 걸 알 수 있게 되는 거를 포착하는 어떤 특별한 눈이나 이런 게 분명히 있으신 것 같아요. 그게 흑인들에 대한 이미지에 대한 우리의 어떤 단순한 동일화하는 어떤 습관을 깨주는 지점도 있습니다만 그게 역으로 또 우리로 보자면 다른 좀 일반적인 함의를 분명히 또 갖는 것도 있는 것 같아요. 흑인들에 대한 우리의 생각 자체가 그렇다면 그 반대급부로 그러니까 그런 맥락 안에서 그 말씀해 주신 것들이 대단히 도움이 될 거라는 생각이 들고 요거 맥락 안에서 그러면 이 요번에 이 지금 전시하는 거에 대한 얘기를 이제 같이 맞물려서 한두 개 더 던져 드리자면 요런 어떤 그 뭐랄까요 이 힌트를 가지고 이 감독님께서 이번에 이거를 다 셀렉션을 요 보이는 걸 하셨다고 들었는데 2011년에 휘트니에서도 이제 큰 한번 그 엑스비션 있으셨습니다만 그거하고 좀 차이가 만약 있다고 하면 혹은 이미 보셨거나 아직 많이 안 보셨는데 남은 한 일주일 정도 있는 시간 동안에 좀 봐주셨으면 좋겠다는 괜 재밌겠다 요건 꼭 놓치지 않으셨으면 좋겠다 나의 어떤 그 작업하는 데 있어 그래서 핵심을 놓치지 않으려면 그런 게 있다면 어떻게 될 건지 그러니까 이 셀렉션의 원칙과 놓치지 않으셨으면 하는 작품이 한 두세 개 정도 이렇게 말씀을 해주시면 어떨까 싶습니다.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was trying to just get new work, I think. But there was some curatorial, and I was trying to remember what the curatorial decisions were. And yes, it does. I think just Park Lanes. I think that's always the kind of signature film. I was happy to make that thing because it's like long, and then it has. But there's one individual that stayed the whole 4 hours, the second half of my the 72-year-old gentleman, who we love, stayed for the film. But I think every time when I put together these programs, I think I want to just kind of show my artistic mythology, I think, so to speak. I'm trying not to get films that look alike, you know. So they're. I think a lot of people say it, like I make people don't know from year to year what I'm going to make because they had. I'm trying to exercise different formal qualities, I think, when I'm making films. Here.
예, 이제 적당하게 질문을 플로우에서 받으면 괜찮을 거라는 생각이 좀 드는데요. 뭐 개별적인 작품에 대한 것이든지 아니면 오늘 처음 오셨다 하더라도 오늘 지금 보셨던 거나 말씀 들으셨던 것들 관련해서 질문 그 궁금하신 게 있으시거나 하시면 지금 하시면 되게 좋을 예, 것 같습니다.
관객으로서 처음 느꼈던 거는 그 뭐 지금 이렇게 뭐 인종 문제 이런 얘기 하셨는데 저는 그렇게 와닿았다기보다도 어떤 아이러니와 그냥 한계 상황 그런데 그 속에서 담담함 이런 것들을 이렇게 느꼈거든요. 그러니까 예를 들면 뭐 퀄리티 컨트롤 이런 영화 보면 굉장히 열심히 다림질을 하지만 사실 우리 누구나 자신의 인생은 별로 그렇게 펴주지 않는 경우가 많고 그렇게 뭐라 그럴까 사실 우리 삶은 우리 열심히 노동을 해서 그렇게 뭔가 달라지게 만들지만 우리 삶의 한계라는 거는 좀 고정되어 있는 측면이 있잖아요. 그리고 찰리스 프루프라는 그거에 보면 맨 처음에 이 그 재즈 연주가 블루스 연주가의 인터뷰를 담은 내용이라고 여기도 이렇게 설명이 나와 있지만 거기서 보면 이 마을이 예전에는 어떠어떠했다라고 하면서 그 과거의 얘기를 하지만 사실 이 사람은 정말 아이러니하게도 연주자한테 파리 한쪽 그를 이룬 상태인데 어떻게 해서 이렇게 됐고 어떻게 해서 자기 얘기는 자기의 과거 얘기는 별로 하지 않는 그래서 예전에 이 마을이 어떠어떠했다라는 것이 도리어 예전에 내가 어떠어떠했다라는 얘기는 안 하지만 그것이 합리적으로 들어가 있는 듯한 그러면서 오히려 굉장히 그 연주자의 쓸쓸함을 느끼게 하는 그리고 스톤 같은 거 보면 막 이렇게 도박하는 것 같지만 사실 아이들이 돌이 어디 있다 여기 있다 막 하지만 정작 이 남자는 여기 있다라고 해서 고정돼 있는 그 돌 이 사람이 절대 여기라고 하면은 그 고정돼 있는 그 돌의 위치가 정확히 나오잖아요 그러니까 그 뭐랄까 고정돼 있는 내가 아무리 여기다 저기다 얘기를 해도 별로 바뀌지 않는 삶에 대한 거 그래서 관객의 입장에서는 굉장히 쓸쓸함이나 어떤 아이러니를 느끼면서도 어떤 인연에서는 굉장히 당당하기 때문에 희망적인 그런 메시지가 있었는데 사실 감독님의 그 굉장히 철학적인 내용과 관객은 그냥 보는 거 외에는 별로 예술적인 지식이 없는지라 오히려 관객 입장에서는 굉장히 그런 점이 인상적이었는데 사실 관객들이 어떻게 영화를 봐줬으면 좋겠다 아니면 어떤 그냥 단편적으로라도 어떻게 받아들일 수 있겠다 해줬으면 하는 그런 감독으로서의 메시지가 있는지 아주 보편적인 메시지가 있는지 궁금합니다.
No, not really. It's a message, but okay, yeah.
꼭 메시지가 있었던 건 아닙니다.
Oh, but you can go no, not we can go long, but. But no, but I like your interpretation. You know, that's fine. Especially with quality control. Like the camera is on that woman for 11 minutes, so you, the viewer, can attach any situation or any narrative or anything to that particular person. That's spot on. If you know something, I didn't. You know, and then that's you. Maybe that is. My message in a weird way, because it is kind of open-ended. There's no, like, I'm not given or not putting in an equation that needs an answer, so to speak, you know, so you can interpret it any way you can, yeah, yeah. And especially Charlie's proof, because he was being coy, because he used to be a criminal, you know, so he didn't want to talk about, I was trying to get him to talk about that kind of stuff, so he wasn't, so that was the kind of dialogue, but, But yeah, I think this kind of open-endedness of it and the ability to, and there is a bit of pride in everybody, or I frame it so there is a little bit of pride, you know. And even when people aren't proud, I frame it respectfully. So I'm usually respectful to the subject matter. And so that comes up, and then so the viewer can add anything they want to. I think if I'm disrespectful to the subject matter, well, then you'll see it, you know. So I try not to do that. Yeah, yeah. About that respect, yeah. There's an American filmmaker who I like called Harmony Korine. He made a film called Gummo, Trash Humpers, Spring Breakers. What else? Maybe Spring Breakers. Yeah. I mean, I like his work. But the way he frames people up, he creates a zoo mentality where he distances himself from the subject matter. Like, he'll find the strangest, craziest white people, and the way he frames it up is that he's not that person, you know, and most of viewers is. So we're looking at the individual as if they're in a zoo, you know, so to speak. And then I don't like that type of filmmaking. I mean, like that's an option, but I'd rather not have the subject matter look at that. Because people always ask me, "Do I make films for an audience?" And I say, "No, I make films for the subject matter because I respect the subject matter." Does that make sense?
답변이 되셨나요?
예.
Yeah. 그리고 지금 방금 하나만 말씀하셨던 거에 제가 덧붙여도 되겠냐 했을 때 그러셨다고 하셔서 하나만 덧붙이자면 오늘 아까 말씀하셨던 거하고 그러니까 한편으로는 제 작품은 여러 가지로 해석될 수 있습니다. 열려 있습니다라는 말은 사실은 많은 분들이 얘기하잖아요. 근데 그거와 약간 차이가 있는 점이 뭐냐면 이분 거기서 이제 아까 그 제스처하고 액션을 나누는 지점이 거기서 나오는 것 같아요. 그러니까 제스처 액션은 닫혀 있는 거라면 보여있을 때 주먹을 주면 누굴 때린다든지 시작과 결말이 명확하다면 제스처는 그게 사실 좀 열려 있는 거거든요. 이게 뭘 하려고 주먹을 쥐는 건지 전후를 사실 애매하게 예측하기 힘들고 또 재밌는 건 그게 잠깐 하고 끝나는 게 아니라 반복이 오랫동안 된다는 거죠. 오랫동안 지속이 됐는데 열려 있을 수 있다는 건 쉽지 않은 거거든요. 그러니까 여기에서 이 퍼포먼스적인 차원에 있어서의 그 제스처를 얘기하는 지점이 저 영화는 아무렇게나 뭐 아니 아무렇게나 아닙니다. 여러 가지 해석될 수 있습니다라는 말과 약간 이분이 갖고 있는 나름의 뭐 방법론이랄까 그 차원에서 주목을 해볼 만한 지점이라는 얘기가 앞에 얘기가 그렇게 맞물린다는 그 얘기는 짚어드리면 좋을 거라는 생각이 좀 들었습니다. 예, 또 다른.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I want to do one more thing, and then also too, the films aren't really about race, in a weird way. I think for the sake of us being here, I use African American as a description, and also too because I'm African American, but also there's a different set of histories. When I'm looking through the viewfinder, I look at not just all African Americans, but some African Americans. And then we have a different set of histories than most people in the United States, and then that backstory is allowed to seep in, so to speak. Yeah.
첫 번째 질문은 제가 이제 한 번밖에 안 남은 파크레인지를 보려고 하고 있거든요. 그래가지고 이게 8시간이어가지고 과연 다 볼 수 있을지 몰라가지고 혹시 작가 이거 감독님께서 이거 어떻게 하면 이걸 8시간 동안 자지 않고 볼 수 있을지. 그리고 저 두 번째로 하고 싶은 거는 저 화면에 있는 것이 뭘 상징하는 건지 저 로고가 좀 궁금했거든요. 영화 끝날 때마다 저기 나와가지고. 그리고 저 문장도 정확하게 무슨 뜻인지도 알고 싶습니다.
Well, I would be disappointed if you didn't stay the whole 8 hours.
우선은 8시간 끝까지 버티시지 않으면 제가 크게 실망할 거고요.
Yeah. People bring their own food and pillow and then they get a, oh, you can't eat in here? Oh, that's rough. Yeah, it's sneaking in or just, you know, you could, as long as you don't. Yeah, and trilobite, it's a fossil. It's the state fossil of Ohio. In the United States, our politicians debated in what would be the good state fossil of Ohio. It's something that's absurd, but I have a sense of identity because I'm from Ohio. So what's the official fossil of Seoul?
We don't need a fossil. I don't think we have.
I beg the difference. You need a fossil.
제가 그래서 아니 주에서 왜 주를 상징하는 화석이 필요하냐고 그랬더니 서울도 있지 않냐고 물어보시는데 혹시 알고 계신 분 있나요?
그 제가 이제 듣기로 오늘 이렇게 들은 결과로는 키워드 두 가지가 대상 물질하고 타임베이스 같아요. 그걸 두 가지를 갖고 어떠한 내러티브 속에 섞어서 흘러가는가에 따라서 이제 작품이 되는 것 같은데 곽 선생님이 여러 번 문제를 제기한 것이 어떠한 대상 물질을 어떠한 타임 베이스의 내러티브에 섞어서 할 때 이거는 우리가 이렇게 어떤 레퍼런스를 갖죠. 아 이런 게 이렇게 섞여 있으면 이런 카테고리에 속할 거야라고 추측을 하는데 이게 아닌 것 같다라는 곽윤부 선생님께서 프레임은 달리하지만 같은 동종의 질문을 여러 번 제기를 하셨습니다. 근데 제가 이제 생각하기에는 그거에 대한 어떤 해답이 오늘 선생 뭐 에버슨 씨도 여러 번 말씀을 하셨지만 어떤 그 인터뷰에서 제가 봤는데요. 에버슨 씨가 여러 가지 그러니까 기자가 질문을 하니까 나는 예술가다라는 얘기를 굉장히 여러 번 반복하세요. 그러시면서 나는 다큐멘터리 작가도 아니고 저널리스트도 아니고 나는 예술가야. 그 얘기를 참 여러 번 하셔서 이게 그러면 오늘 곽 선생님이 여러 번 질문하신 그거 우리가 이미 갖고 있는 학습된 어떤 레퍼런스에 속하지 않는 왜냐하면 아주 낯익은 어떤 대상 물질과 타임 베이스와 내러티브인데도 불구하고 낯익은 레퍼런스에 속하지 않는 이유는 작가가 이러한 나는 예술가라는 강한 정체성을 갖고 확신을 갖고 대상을 대하는 어떤 특별한 자기만의 태도가 있지 않을까? 왜 그렇게 나는 예술가라는 그 확언을 여러 번 거듭하면서 그 저널리스트나 다큐멘터리 작가하고 차별화를 강조를 하거든요. 그러면 대상에 대해서 접근하는 방법 아니면 보는 시각이 확실하게 어떤 다르기 때문에 예술가로서의 감각이 다르기 때문에 그러한 어떤 레퍼런스에도 속하지 않는 것이 아닐까라는 생각이 들거든요. 그래서 궁금한 것은 에버슨 씨께서 나는 예술가라는 그런 확언을 여러 번 거듭하시는데 그것이 어떤 말씀이신지 좀 부언해서 설명을 듣고 싶어요. 그러니까 대상 물질에 대해서 혹은 타임베이스에 대해서 어떤 식으로 접근하길래 나는 예술가라는 거를 그렇게 여러 번 강조를 하시면서 다른 장르의 예술가들하고 이렇게 차별을 두시는지 그게 궁금합니다.
I guess the difference would be up to somebody else because I always think we're all doing it the same. I'm completely self-centered, so I think, you know, we're all doing it the same. So I mean, that's a good question. I mean, I don't know how much different I am from other people, but I know what I do. Yeah, and I guess it is a certain sense of competence. Like, I know what I want to do, I guess, whatever. And so as an artist, it's important to know what I want to do. I'm trying to, like... Yeah, but you gotta know what you like. Now my tone changed. Hear that? But then you gotta. I guess to keep moving forward, you gotta know what you're doing. I guess, or at least have an inclination of what you're doing. Yeah, as a professor, like I try to tell students, it's not important for me to know what the student does, but it's my job to make sure they know what they're doing, which is the hardest thing. Because sometimes a lot of people think it's luck, that they don't really know what they're doing, so I have to make sure they know all the sophisticated relationships that go into making that object, whatever that object is. And so me, as an artist, I understand all the sophisticated relationships that go into what I'm making. Yeah. Whatever that, so those sophisticated relationships could be, it could be color, it could be sound, it could be camera, it could be weather, you know, all these elements that go into it, yeah. As subject matter, whatever.
저는 이제 조금 개인적이고 실용적인 질문을 드리고 싶은데 이걸 통해서 오늘 이제 배경 설명을 해주신 것 때문에 제가 봤던 뭐 흑백의 혹은 소리가 뭐 많지 않은 영화들이 의미가 있었던 것처럼 좀 더 개인적인 질문을 좀 드리고 싶은데 두 가지 질문이 있습니다. 혹시 삶에서 어떤 차이점이 생겼는지에 대한 질문인데요. 첫 번째는 처음 작품을 만드실 때랑 이제 대학교에서 학생들을 가르치고 나서 어떤 작품에 대해서 설명하시기 시작하면서 생긴 좀 뭐 작업의 방식이라든지 아니면 어떤 좀 개념적인 것의 변화가 있는지가 궁금하고요. 두 번째는 사실 2017년에 뭐 미국의 흑인들을 이야기하더라도 상황이나 세상이 많이 바뀌었는데 여전히 뭐 리차드 프레이의 이야기에 나오는 그런 삼촌들을 여전히 찾아야 되는 큰 동기가 있다면 그게 뭔지 좀 궁금하다는 생각이 듭니다.
Yeah, right on. Thanks. Yeah, actually that's a good thing about a good question about teaching. I hate to admit it, but it totally influences what I do. Because I teach at the University of Virginia. Prior to that, I was at the University of Tennessee, and there I taught film and photography and new genre, like installation, performance art. And then at the time, I did all of those. And now I only teach film, and that's all I do. I make sculpture objects for some of the films. And then sometimes I exhibit those, but it's primary film. So, yeah, like teaching. And then I only realized this like a couple of years ago. I was like, no, you know, I didn't know. Yeah, so it does totally influence that, yeah.
And what was that second question?
Second question is, the minor characters, Richard Pryor's uncle. Yeah. You're still interested in them?
I like it. Yeah. I don't let outside influences dictate what I do. And I was telling young Ben that I don't center the ruling class. So I know a lot of people. There's been the big thing that's always been big in the United States is like police brutality, African Americans, and hell, I was beaten up by cops as a 17-year-older. So it's always been going on. And then, so the only reason why it's pertinent now, because the ruling class doesn't believe the oral tradition. They have to see everything. And even there's old Richard Pryor jokes from the 60s about police brutality, you know. So the fact that, you know, if my work kind of has all that in there, you know, I don't have to put it on the surface, so to speak, yeah.
미국에는 왜 양쪽 코스트의 지형과 그 말씀하신 미드웨스트나 뭐 중서부의 지형이나 그런 문화적인 환경이 꽤 다른데 작품 활동을 하실 때 그런 환경적인 요인이 작업의 그런 그러니까 단순히 배경으로서뿐만이 아니라 어떤 형식적인 요인이라든가 조금 더 전반적인 영향을 미친다고 생각을 하시는지 궁금합니다.
Like what?
예를 들어서 어떤 거요?
그러니까 저는 주로 그 작업을 그러니까 도심이나 이런 데서 하시기보다 뭐 미시시피라거나 뭐 오하이오주를 또 그때 자라신 배경이나 이런 환경적인 요인을 말씀드린 거거든요.
그러니까 그런 환경 외에 다른
아니요 그 환경인데 그가 단순히 그러니까 인물들을 배경으로 삼는 것뿐만이 아니라 그러니까 저는 보통 사람이 어떤 환경에서 자라느냐에 따라서 뭐 사고 과정이라거나 그런 다양한 영향을 받는다고 저는 생각을 하게 되는데 그리고 저도 실제로 미드웨스트에서 살았었거든요. 그렇기 때문에 뭔가 페이스라거나 그런 거에 저는 차이를 느꼈었고 그리고 작품에서도 그러니까 주로 뭐 저희가 미국이라고 했을 때 지배적으로 알려진 뭐 LA라거나 뉴욕시티나 이런 데가 아닌 그런 다른 곳들을 많이 볼 수 있기 때문에 저는 그런 장소에서 작업을 하시면서 단순히 백그라운드로서가 아니라 더 그 추가로 어떤 영감이나 영향을 받으시는 부분이 있는지.
Yeah, I think it's mostly where they are, but also language. Like people talk differently. In Charlie's Proof, I could barely understand the guy. You know, I was just like, which for me, it's like fun, you know. So I think mostly, you know, like your environment totally affects where you from. If you're from a place where it's mountainous, it affects light, you know. Where I live now, there's hardly any sunsets, or sunsets aren't long because I live in a hilly region as opposed to growing up in the flat region where you had sun glare, a lot more sun glare. So you know, it always affects you. But also, I like how language changes. Because Charlie Smith in Charlie's Proof, he grew up in segregated schools where it was all black, you know, and he speaks differently from people who grew up in integrated schools. And even in Park Lanes, the lunch scene, I knew these gentlemen grew up in segregated schools, and I wanted that language. I don't even know what they're saying half the time. But it, for me, it was an interesting form. And I don't know. And again, I may not get that, but it's for the subject matter to get that, because then they'll know that situation. So I think language would be, I just want to be clear. Yeah, I think it'd be mostly language. And even in America, you can tell, America's huge. Again, it's in migration, it's important because I can go to Oakland, California, and I know they're from Arkansas because of the language. Yeah, and I can go to Chicago, Southside Chicago, and they're from Mississippi. You know, you could just say, oh, and then certain things would come out to you. So I like that as form too. So mostly language. Yeah. And real quick, in Park Lanes, it's not just African Americans. It's Laotian American and Vietnamese American, and we did interview people, but I didn't put it in a film, but I have a series of trailers that are interviews, and I picked the Laotians to, just when the war ended in the mid-70s, the Vietnamese and Laotians lived in African-American neighborhoods, and I was like attuned to the ear of when they were speaking. Yeah. So that sometimes dictates what I film.
또 바리 랭귀지랑 연결된 점도 있을 수도 있겠죠. 그렇게 보면 또 아까 얘기랑도 다시 연결될 수 있고 한 분 정도 아까 이쪽 가운데 어디?
아, 전 컨템퍼리 아트가 뭔지 좀 설명해 주셨으면 좋겠어요.
Could somebody? 네, 짧게 얘기하셔가지고 지금 당황하셨습니다. Could either of you explain? What is contemporary art?
I can't. Oh, but of course. Maybe she's wondering how we work being together. Yeah. because I explain it all the time. I could go on. I know in the United States, contemporary art, I mean, this is a long lecture. What people were responding to was a result of the age of engineering and like objects like, you know, like architecture and photography, and then people were responding to how fast things were being made and how fast the corporal body was moving places. And then how fast information was. And then so the whole idea of like, you know, carving marble seemed obsolete, you know, marble sculpture and stuff like that. So I think this kind of the speed of things. So probably after mid 1920s in the United States, then the whole idea of what modern is what modernity is basically like could be when people think progress, things could be getting better, so to speak. But I think contemporary art it doesn't have that view where things to get better, so to speak. But you do have these kind of objects and elements that were made from speed, so a lot of things become obsolete. You know, the whole idea, like you want to make things kind of fast and stuff, and your viewing will change too as well. And then what artists were responding to, not just like the pictorial landscape, so to speak, but also the materialities that were to make that pictorial landscape, like straight, like this regular paint. And then so artists started to make abstract paintings, and then it reflected the object more so than the view, the vista, so to speak. And then so that was affected, I think, through the age of engineering. And postmodern and contemporary art was basically after the 70s, it wasn't necessary to get the body there fast. Like in the United States, like there's no trip to the moon no more. Like, in fact, actually, we became slower. Like, you know, it take you forever to fly across country because you have layovers and stuff. You know, so, and then it became more information. And then so the art became about expressing information, so to speak. So to put me in that context was like I'm trying to convey more information. So you would respond to the work as information as to more it being a view or a vista, so to speak. In a nutshell. That's 15 weeks condensed to like 7. which reduces it to a system of signs, and then the signs can be read as opposed to be looked at.
대표 작품으로 보여주셨던 클립 영상들을 보니까 대부분 트라이포드나 스테빌라이저를 쓰시지 않고 그리고 또 굉장히 낮은 해상도의 영상들로 작업을 하셨더라고요. 그 뭐 같이 차를 타시거나 이런 장면은 어쩔 수 없다 치더라도 뭐 예를 들면 그 볼링 만드는 공장인가요? 그컷 같은 경우에는 대부분의 경우 삼각대를 썼을 것 같은데 그런 장면에서도 굉장히 오랫동안 핸드헬드 상태로 지켜보시는 느낌이 들어서 그런 방식을 선택하신 이유가 뭔지 좀 궁금합니다.
Most of the time when I do handheld is so the viewer knows that there's somebody holding the camera. So although, you know, the definition of like an image, there's always somebody present. There's somebody has to take the picture or whatever like that. But when I don't use a tripod, it's almost like a brushstroke. Like I want the viewer to know that there's somebody immediately behind the camera. So that's what happens a lot of times. But it depends on the subject matter. And I think the films I showed, except for the moon and the guy blowing out the candles, like, you know, there was no need to show immediate authorship, so to speak. Yeah.
네, 되게 그 두 벌써 두 시간 반이 지났는데 장시간 동안 같이 해주신 분들 너무 감사드리고요. 아까 말씀드렸던 것처럼 여기 오늘 좀 자극이 되신다거나 하시는 분들은 다음 주 주말까지 특히 토요일 제 기억으로 맞다면 토요일에 파크레인이 8시간, 4시간씩 나눠서 또 상영을 하거든요. 그런 작품도 그렇고 다른 단편들도 제가 보기에도 아까 잠깐 초반에 말씀드렸지 재밌는 것들이 되게 많습니다. 여러 가지 함의들 중에 저는 이 다른 인터뷰 중에서 아까 달 나오는 장면이 있었습니다만 그것 같은 것처럼 추상적인 것 같은 걸 하니까 어떤 미국의 어떤 평론가인가 뭐 질문이 왜 이런 걸 흑인이신데 달 이런 걸 하시냐고 그러니까 이분이 제임스 베닝이라고 유명한 뭐 풍경 이렇게 하신 분 있죠. 그런 백인한테는 그런 질문 안 하는데 왜 나한테는 그런 질문을 하느냐라는 말씀하신 적이 있는데 그렇다고 또 흑인들에 대한 얘기를 다루지 않는 것도 아닌 게 되게 재미있는 것 같아요. 어떻게 벗어나고 싶으면 그걸 아예 안 다루면 되는데 그리고 이것도 아니고 저것도 아닌 사회적 어떤 그 긴장 관계를 유지하는 게 대단히 흥미롭다는 생각이 들고 그게 기존의 어떤 여러 가지 우리가 이렇게 툴들 어떤 이렇게 분석하고나 읽어낼 수 있는 것들 아닌 것들을 자기 나름대로 영상 안에서 만들어내는 게 대피사체만 가지고 그걸 할 수 있다는 게 쉽지 않으리라는 생각이 들고 그런 것들이 저희에게도 뭐 건축하시는 분들은 뭐 만들 때 헌재 건축에다가 이렇게 뭐 어떻게 기와를 얹으면 뭐 세계화 되지 않냐 이런 농담하시는 분들이 있었었는데 그런 고민들을 아마 여기 영역 다르시다 하더라도 고민을 하실 텐데 그런 맥락에서도 충분히 어떤 그 여러 가지 함의가 있을 수 있는 전시라고 생각하니까요. 시간 나실 때마다 보시면 좋을 것 같다는 생각 들고 오늘 또 장시간 같이 함께 해주신 케빈 제롬 에버슨 이 작가님께도 큰 박수 한번 주시면 또 감사하겠습니다.
Oh, thank you.
네, 감사합니다.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
아 예, 저 엄청나게 기다리지 않으시고 같이 해주신 예, 네, 인정 통해서니까도 감사드립니다.